Hi, I am Pulkit Agrawal, faculty in the Computer Science Department at MIT, and I direct the Improbable AI Lab. Let me begin with asking you a question. Is it harder, or does it require more intelligence to play a game of chess or to open a door? You will be surprised with the answer. Today's AI systems can beat the best humans at the game of chess, at game of Go. They can perform incredibly complex reasoning tasks, right? And you might have heard about, you know, ChatGPT, which is an impressive system doing language reasoning. But when it comes to doing actual physical tasks, actual physical intelligence, these systems are actually quite terrible. So if you want a robot which can open doors or climb up on stairs or, you know, pick up a hammer and put in a nail, you'll be surprised how bad today's robots are. And what we are trying to do is to change this, right? So what we are trying to build is robot as an API. There are many tasks that humans should not be doing today. And, you know, there are other things which, you know, are simply too tedious, right? And there are other things, you know, which require a lot of thought. For example, how are we going to support an elderly population? We probably want robots to assist them with daily living. Or things like space exploration, where robots have to go and humans just simply cannot go. So let me tell you a bit more about how are we giving these robots superpowers, right? And this is our space. This is the Improbable AI Lab. And let me talk to you about some of the projects that we are doing. So, you know, today, you know, robots can grab objects quite well. For example, I can grab this hammer. But just grabbing it is not sufficient, because to use it, I have to hold it from the handle. I cannot hammer like this. So what I'll do is I'll reorient it with my hand so I can go do this hammering operation. So how can robotic systems do this? You know, this has remained a challenging problem. So now this project over here, you know, if we give it an object, it can reorient it to the goal orientation that we wanted, so that our robots have the superpower of lifting objects and reorienting them so that they can start using tools, something which is quite hard to do today. Now, it's not just about manipulating single objects, but robots have to deal with scenes of objects, because that is how households look like, that is how industry settings look like, this is how our world looks like. It is composed of objects. So, you know, let me, you know, describe you, you know, how some of these systems work and what are some of the challenges, right? So, you know, imagine, you know, you left your room, right? And you wanted the robot to clean it up, right? You might want it to now pick up the book, you know, again, reorient it, but now decide how to keep it in the bookshelf, right? Now, this book may not actually be visible because it might be behind some other objects. So there are cameras which are giving this robot perception. But, you know, this has to deal with occluded objects. Objects which are only partially visible, the lighting conditions can keep on changing. So this is about perceiving scenes, about getting robotic vision correct, right? But it's not just about, you know, observing things visually. You know, once I pick something up, I can feel how it feels like, in the sense I know if it is slipping or how much force I need to apply. Now, these things become quite critical if, for example, I take a screwdriver, I'm trying to screw something, or if I take a knife, I'm trying to cut vegetables, we need to feel the forces. Now, so what we are developing are algorithms which work with touch sensors. Right? So these are touch sensors that we have on a three-finger manipulator. Now, it turns out that, you know, there haven't been robust enough touch sensors which have existed. So we are collaborating with other labs in CSAIL at MIT to develop these touch sensors and develop algorithms which can process touch signals. So we can give robots a superpower of touch and also combine them with visual sensing, which is a field known as learning from multiple modalities. You know, so we can combine touch, vision, sound, and other sensors which might be there. Let me show you some other stuff. So you might be wondering, you know, what is it that is causing this paradigm shift in robotics? So the one idea is that robots which existed were programmed by humans and they couldn't leverage data to improve. What we are developing are algorithms which enables robots to learn from experience. The big success stories which have happened in computer vision, in natural language processing, have relied on the ability to leverage large amounts of data. But how can robots leverage large amounts of data? Right? That is what we are pushing on. And this includes work on algorithms such as reinforcement learning, imitation learning, and generally speaking, learning for control. It's not just in robotics that the algorithms we develop have applications. You can consider that, you know, if you have a recommendation system, you want the user to keep coming back so that you can maximize your profit. Or you want to decide which website layout should I be using. These are examples of sequential decision-making problems. Or for instance, designing a drug. Or for instance, taking decisions in a hospital for providing good healthcare, or in logistics, or in product design. So wherever there is sequential decision making, some of these algorithms could potentially be useful. Right? Now, the other question which you might be wondering is, hey, if I am going to leverage, you know, data to improve robots or to these systems, where is this data going to come from? So one possibility is to collect this data in the actual real world, but data collection can be expensive and potentially be unsafe. So what we can do is collect data in simulation. And what we have developed is technology which can take, you know, policies or agents trained in simulation and successfully transfer them in the real world. So let me demonstrate to you, you know, that in context of locomotion. So this is our locomotion space. And you know, this is one of the robots called the Bag. You know, so you probably will see some videos of this robot running outside. And all of this was trained in simulation and deployed in the real world. Now, because these systems can learn from experience, you know, after they learn to walk, they can start doing other things. So Yandong over here will show, you know, this robot trying to now kick soccer ball and play around with it. Right. Thank you so much for your time, and I'm very excited that you will hear from some of the students in our lab about these projects in more detail.